I'm delighted to welcome you all, and I'm shortly going to hand over to Paul Bauman, the editor of Commonweal, to make the introduction for tonight's speaker. Before I do, let me just say that there are several people in the audience, two of whom I have already spoken to, who are part of the new Commonweal community groups. And if you are one of those people who hasn't yet said hi to me, after tonight's presentation, we'll sit in a corner down here when everyone else has left and chat about how we want to organize ourselves going forward. And of course, if you're in this audience and you have never heard of this thing and you will be interested in participating in it, then by all means, stay too. It's a group of people committed to Commonweal magazine and its values and its identity who want to talk about the issues that are raised in the journal and beyond. So after Rand has spoken, we will have a couple of microphones, and you will be welcome to ask questions, make comments, or indeed challenge anything he has to say. So without more ado, let me hand over to Paul Bauman, who will introduce Rand Cooper. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming out tonight. It's a great pleasure to have you here. Paul, thank you again for organizing this series of lectures. Our collaboration with Fairfield means a great deal to Commonweal. When I asked tonight's speaker for the most pertinent information to use in making this introduction, his advice to me was, keep it short. That's usually his advice to me. Curiously, however, he then sent me a 5,000-word autobiographical sketch. Such are the complexities and contradictions, not to mention the many accomplishments, of my good friend Rand Cooper. Happily, I'm an editor who knows how to separate the wheat from the chaff. Rand grew up in New London, Connecticut, and most tellingly, graduated from Amherst College, a fact he is not likely to let you forget. He has an MA from the Breadloaf School of English at Middlebury. He is the author of a novel, The Last to Go, and a story collection, Big as Life. His fiction has appeared in Harper's, The Atlantic, Esquire, GQ, Commonweal, and many other magazines. Rand has been a writer in residence at Amherst, as well as Emerson College. He was for many years a regular contributor to the New York Times Book Review. For a decade, he was a contributing editor and travel correspondent for Bon Appetit, intrepidly crossing the globe in search of the perfect meal in the perfect setting. Nice work if you can get it. He just completed a stint as a restaurant reviewer for the Connecticut section of the New York Times. Yes, in addition to his literary talents, he is a foodie. He cooks often, a fact my wife never tires of pointing out to me. Perhaps most annoyingly, Rand speaks German like an Übermensch, as well as French and Swahili. He picked up Swahili while in Africa on a Watson Fellowship. I could go on, but I must be brief. Most impressive of all, of course, Rand has been an essayist, movie and book reviewer, and blogger for Commonweal for many years, and is now one of our contributing editors. He has also done yeoman's work as a freelance editor for us. I met Rand at what now seems a lifetime or two ago, when we were both teaching at a country day school in New London. Only days after our first meeting, he was hospitalized with a recurrence of malaria that he contracted in Africa. This was painful for him, but seemed rather exotic to me. Who could this adventurer and world traveler be? It turned out that we shared a keen interest in books, in arguing about politics and every other thing, and in basketball. Back in the day, when we were both much taller, we played quite a lot of basketball, and I would occasionally, very occasionally, let him beat me. We both had writerly ambitions, and I have benefited enormously over the years from his advice, his encouragement, and his example. He is a craftsman, a maker of wonderful sentences, and more. The novelist Maureen Howard put it this way in praising Rand's first book, The Last to Go. The intelligence of this book is central, but the stories come from the place of true fiction, the informed heart. I believe that to be true of all of Rand Cooper's writing. It will certainly be true of his remarks tonight. Please welcome Rand Cooper.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you, Paul, and any other Pauls who were here. I do remember the time playing one-on-one basketball against Paul Bauman when we were colleagues. He was losing badly, as befits a graduate of Wesleyan when playing an Amherst College graduate. When his wife and then small children came into the gym, there was a galvanizing and energizing effect upon his abilities, and he subsequently kicked my butt as his wife and small children looked on. It was then that I understood something about marriage. My talk tonight is called Confessions of a Catholic Interloper. I'm going to use the full at least 50 minutes that I have, so be prepared to snooze, leave, or endure. I do want to, even though you're a minority in the audience tonight, speak to the students tonight. It's still very vivid to me, some ancient experiences that I have of this college. My high school girlfriend, the great sweetheart of my teen years, went here. We went to different colleges in different states, and I came to visit here. And those memories are as vivid to me as yesterday, but I recognize that they were, in fact, fully 40 years ago, in fact, almost to the month. And so I gaze at students among you across a big gulf of time. Strange music, a lingo that demarcates you from people my age, that is, people who use words like lingo. And maybe most of all, your immersion in the digital virtual life. You inhabit a kind of foreign country. And only the fact that I, somewhat belatedly, have a fifth grade daughter offers me any hope at all of maintaining diplomatic relations with your country in the future. Anyway, tonight I'm going to take you into the foreign country of the past, of my past. I came up with the idea and the title for this talk, Confessions of a Catholic Interloper, when I was recently invited onto a radio program out of Wesleyan called Reasonably Catholic. Maybe some of you have listened to this program. I told the host that first I didn't think I was a great guest because first I wasn't at all sure I was reasonable. And then, well, I'm not actually Catholic either, I said. Well, I just play one at the magazine. Also recently, my father, who's 88 years old, lives in Tucson, called to tell me that a friend of his had been very excited to read a column I'd written in Commonweal. Your son must be a very committed Catholic, the friend said. My dad laughed. Last I checked, he told his friend, Rand was a very lapsed Congregationalist. So, there, I'm finally outed after all these years, a fake Catholic. In fact, I've had a long career as a fake Catholic, as an interloper, going back to seventh grade when my parents enrolled me in St. Joseph's School in New London. Little did they know they were starting me on an encounter with Catholicism to last a lifetime. A writer is a kind of spy, and I'm convinced that being dropped into the Catholic world helped make me one. So tonight I want to offer some stories and insights gleaned from my years as an infiltrator, first at a Catholic school, then at a Catholic magazine. I'm going to do this with a mix of storytelling, essay writing, and book reviewing, which is pretty much the trifecta of what I do. I may even, toward the end, do a bit of singing. Fair warning. In the process, I'll use these two concepts, Protestant and Catholic, to sketch some differing ideas about the self in its relation to existence and to other selves, and offer up some thoughts upon what I'm calling American loneliness. That's actually an unpublished subtitle of my talk, Thoughts on American Loneliness. So, let me first describe briefly for you the Protestantism that I lapsed from, as my father said. He himself grew up in Philadelphia in a white, working class, totally Protestant, totally Republican neighborhood, if you can add all that up. His parents were Episcopalians, but in his career he became a surgeon, and his religion turned out to be science and upward mobility, two forms of materialism. Like religious faith itself, atheism can come upon you suddenly as a revelation, or gradually while you're not paying attention, or maybe even trying to avoid it. My father was that latter kind of atheist. When I was a kid, he was looking to recuse himself from church going because it conflicted with his commitment to Sunday morning tennis, but to do so as quietly as possible in the wan hope that my mother might not notice. This all blew up one memorable Sunday when I was 10. We were coming out of church. My mother and my sister were walking ahead of us on the sidewalk as my dad and I lagged behind. I'd torn off my clip-on tie, unbuttoned my strangulating dress shirt, and was reveling in that post-church feeling of liberation. Maybe I could sense that my father felt likewise. "Dad," I asked him, do you like going to church? What do you really think of it?" He glanced ahead. "Don't tell your mother this," he confided, "but I think it's a crock." "Mom!" I yelled, racing up the sidewalk. "Dad says church is a crock!" For me, religion to me was our church, Second Congregational. Let me evoke it for you. A graceful stone building on a big green lawn. It was lovely, but severely underoccupied, like the baseball stadium of a chronically losing team, the small congregation scattered in the front seats, the bleachers empty. Religion meant the museum-like somnolence of Sunday service, my mother nudging me when I fidgeted too much and discreetly handing me a mint to pacify me. It was the clink of the communion shot glasses filled with grape juice. No communal slurping from a shared chalice, but individual Protestant portions, neat and hygienic, rattling in the deacon's tray. For me, it was 100 minutes of boredom, where the only action whatsoever was waiting to place my offering envelope with my dollar bill that my mother had given me inside, into the velvet bottom collection bowl. I'd while away the time by wondering if the words doxology and dachshund might be related. Or by trying to count the little carved crenellations on the oak paneling above the choir pews. Everyone around me, meanwhile, was lost in some strange private zone, surfacing to mumble a half-hearted prayer or sing a half-hearted hymn, then subsiding again as our minister, Mr. McLeod, droned on about our obligation to help those less fortunate. Religion, above all, was a private thing, individual and inward. My mother's faith was focused on her own obscure spiritual yearnings and on the pastor's sermon, which she expected to be moved by. And later, in fact, she turned into quite a church shopper, always on the lookout for a more inspired minister. "Oh, I'm through with him," she'd say when we came home from college and asked how it was going in her latest church. The church as community not only didn't interest her, it vaguely repelled her. Years later, we joked that what our mom truly longed for, her dream congregation, was the church of Leave Me the Hell Alone. And in fact, our congregational church was pretty close to that. It wasn't in our neighborhood. We had to drive across town. There was almost no overlap between the people my parents went to church with and the people they socialized with. The notion of church and pastor shopping reveals the modern and very American impulse to treat religion as a consumer good, something to compare, select, change, or discard. Our Protestantism was a belief, yes, but one you could try on, like a jacket, If you didn't like it, you pondered and made your choice. There was a certain self-destructing aspect of Protestantism. Built into the very core of the faith was a mechanism for rejecting the faith. That mechanism came into play in the deal I cut with my mother over confirmation. I'd take the weekly class with Reverend McLeod, but the final decision to be confirmed or not was up to me. This resulted in the crass absurdity of a 13-year-old American kid informing this learned and authentically reverend man, a graduate of Harvard School of Divinity, a man who had studied theology at Tübingen, home of Hegel and Hölderlin, of this kid getting up in that man's face and saying, "No thanks, I don't buy it, I don't think it's true." Now, the appropriate response would well have been, "Who cares what you think? The church doesn't care, I don't particularly care, and I'm certain God does not care." But Mr. McLeod couldn't say that, not just because he was polite, although he was, but because, as I said, his brand of Christianity had that decisional aspect built into it fundamentally. So, goodbye to the green lawn and the graceful stone building. Goodbye to the pastoral voice echoing its drowsy invocation to do good as our small nuclear family passed through, untouched, a lark, another Sunday outing. The water indicates breaks in the structure. In the middle of this, my parents up and decided to send me to St. Joseph's School. No religious reason, they just didn't think the public schools were doing a very good job. I was coasting, I needed some rigor. Well, it was a huge shock to my system. An overindulged smart boy from an upwardly mobile Protestant family colliding with the world of early 1970s small city Catholicism. The shock began right on day one with a point of style. St. Joe's was my first experience of a school uniform. White shirt, dress slacks, plaid black watch, plaid tie. Any individualizing was limited to your accessories. I was something of a clothes horse, and I'd absorbed some highly unfortunate trends of the early 1970s. Specifically, I had a coat inspired by the wardrobe of a flamboyant Pittsburgh Steelers running back of the day, Frenchie Fuqua, who derived his style from popular blaxploitation movies like Shaft. My prize coat was a fake fur coat. Big and shaggy, sort of woolly mammoth-like. And so I showed up for my first day at Catholic school, where I knew no one, looking like a downtown pimp. No sooner had I hit the hallway at St. Joe's than the principal, Father Dempsey, took me aside. It's very impressive, your coat. But it might make it a wee bit harder for you to fit in. Okay, I ditched the coat, and the platform shoes too. But the fitting in part, I soon found out, wasn't gonna happen anyway. As I discovered, St. Joe's was the opposite of the green lawn in almost every respect. The school was a dark and ancient brick building where nothing had been improved for decades. The grounds were a half-acre prison yard of fenced-in blacktop, not a single blade of grass anywhere. There was a hole in the chain-link fence where, if the teacher wasn't watching, you could escape at lunch, then hustle up to the block to the pizza place, Ocean Pizza, cram down an Italian sub, and make it back by the bell. This routine wasn't really about the sandwich. It was about the transgression. The schoolyard pastime was a rough tackling game that began with one boy standing in the center of the blacktop, facing a line of 30 or so others. At a shout of go, that line raced over to the other side, and the one boy in the middle tackled someone, one person. The next time, those two tackled two more, and so on, until at the end, a few last crossers faced a mob of gang tacklers. The game, officially not allowed, but played daily, was brutal, with all sorts of vendettas enacted in the pileups. Girls, those merciless arbiters of manliness, stood watching on the sideline. You had to be tough, or at least act tough. But I couldn't. I was secretly sensitive. And my memories from St. Joe's are full of smothered, shamed bursts of my crying. My grades were too good. I had a baby face. I wouldn't and couldn't fight. The girl I had a crush on was also a good student, and when I walked her home, tough boys followed us, murmuring crude suggestions. The school was staffed by lay teachers and nuns. Nuns were completely new to me. The only nun I knew was Sally Field, the flying nun. Well, the nuns at St. Joe's were not only not flying, some were barely moving, like Sister Catherine Mary, who sat stock still in the world's tiniest library, a converted maintenance closet. She was so old and moved so infrequently, she was rumored among students to be dead and embalmed. Religion class was taught by Sister Thomasina, a baffling experience to me. Every day began with the Pledge of Allegiance and then the Hail Mary, recited in rapid succession as if they were cheers for the same team, reflecting the motto carved in stone in the front of the school in big letters, "For God and Country." St. Joe's brooked no iconoclasm. We were sternly warned not to listen to the rock opera Jesus Christ Superstar, which I loved. Academically, the school wasn't exactly achievement-minded. When I wrote a long-term paper on the Attica State Prison Uprising, which happened that year, my social studies teacher, Mr. Farina, took me aside and accused me of plagiarizing. More hot secret tears from me. Sister Susan, my kindly homeroom teacher, kept me after class one day and tried to probe my unhappiness. Was everything okay at home? Did I need any help? I sat there exploding with misery, staring at the clock on the wall and wishing I could be anywhere else. The clocks at St. Joseph's were antiquated models, those square clocks with Roman numerals that ticked off the minutes, each minute discreetly. I was fascinated by those clocks. How could time, which was continuous, be broken down into stackable, tick-tockable building blocks? Wasn't time round anyway and not square? This kind of thing makes an impression on a future writer. And every time I've written about St. Joe's in stories or essays, I've included those clocks. I'll read a few paragraphs from a story I wrote a number of years ago called Heroes of 1974. It was published in the Iowa Review. Here, the adult narrator is recalling being called to the principal's office because of some troublemaking offense. By the way, whenever I wrote about St. Joseph, I used a different saint, St. Crispin, who was both more interesting to me and also would camouflage the school. And I typically turned myself into a tough, troublemaking kind of kid, for what it's worth. Here's the passage. One afternoon, I was summoned down to Father Connolly. He kept his office in a tiny room crammed with books and diplomas, electric candles, and Jesus dreamily agonizing on his cross. Father Connolly talked to you through the steeple of his fingertips, pressed together in front of his mouth. I was entering a stage of life, he told me, where I would need to be mature. Star athletes were mature. Jesus had been mature, which was why he accepted his father's will, even though he didn't like it. And our school's patron, St. Crispin, he was mature, giving up all his possessions to make shoes for the poor. He wanted to help others, which is what mature people did. I stared at the wall clock. The school's clocks were ancient relics that ticked off the minutes mechanically, and I avoided his gaze. Father Connolly went on talking. Maturity, he pointed out, didn't mean you had to be a shrinking violet. Take St. Crispin, he said. The Romans tortured him. They pulled out his fingernails. He leaned forward. They boiled a cauldron of fat and tar and dunked him in. Can you imagine that? This story didn't make sense to me. If God was so all mature and everything, I said, then why didn't he help Crispin? Ah, but he did. Father Connolly smiled. In fact, he gave him a great gift. He made him a soldier for goodness. And that was his question for me, Father Connolly said. Clearly, from my behavior, I wanted to be a soldier. But what for? This wasn't the kind of question you answered. I sat there. On the clock, the big hand trembled as if it might actually move backward, then clicked ahead. So this passage conveys to me, looking back at it, some of the impression that Catholic school made on me. Early adolescence is a time when a person begins to tangle with the imponderables, mortality and time, our consciousness, our purpose. For me, the very harshness and even the decrepitude of St. Joe's conduced to thinking along those lines. The school exerted a powerful and even oppressive sense of time, of how minutes pile up into hours, then to days, months, years, and lifetimes, and belong beyond that to the collective lifetime of history, and then, finally, to whatever mystery lay beyond that. One's individual existence, my individual existence, was being placed in a different perspective from what I was used to, with different attitudes toward authority, achievement, and individuality. There was an eye fixed on the eternal and a premium placed on obedience and sacrifice, a certain invocation of cruelty in pursuit of encouraging goodness. Being Catholic, at any rate, was certainly not about expressing yourself, whether with a fur coat or with your personal views on God. And so St. Joe's delivered the message that Reverend Mr. McLeod could not. Who cared what you thought about God? Better focus on what God might be thinking about you. In some ways, the school seemed the least religious place on earth. It was not exactly suffused with sacramental energy. I recall the day Sister Thomasina had classmates list saints to adopt as confirmation names, and Steve Stefano and Albert Annibalini listed St. Popeye and St. Bozo. Instant ticket to Father Dempsey's office. And worse, I'm sure, when they got home. At St. Joe's, a great deal of correction was ladled out, and yet recidivism was high. The focus was never on our personal development, with concerned parents called in to confer. Rather, daily life at school wove a tapestry of crime and punishment, sin and penance, two complementary strands, two necessary halves of a basic deal. Kids, of course, see the world in terms of individual personalities and not abstractions, but obviously class and ethnicity lay behind some of my problems fitting in. I lived in the doctors, lawyers, accountants part of town, while other kids at St. Joe's lived in the welders, policemen, coaches part. Most had grandparents born in other countries who spoke other languages, parents who accepted no backtalk and took the mantra of God and country seriously. Unlike my parents, they saw church as the very center of the neighborhood, the center of their lives. I didn't understand any of this yet, but Catholicism and the church had been instrumental in their effort to claw a toehold in the slippery rock of American life. And it was an accomplishment still recent enough for many of them that they could hardly accept that it could ever be optional, let alone dismissed as a crock. Faith, religion, the church, so were not propositions to be pondered. Not an idea, but an identity. In the end, a bureaucratic fluke shook me loose from that world. The archdiocese had built this sparkly new high school, but it was over-enrolled, and non-Catholics were bumped to the end of the waiting list. And so, on a warm spring day in 1973, I visited the one private school in our area, a small modern building ensconced amid birch trees and beautiful gardens on a serene college campus, for an entrance exam. My mother brought me, and as we came in, I saw a pretty young woman sitting on the lawn outside school, reading a book. She smiled as we went in. The receptionist informed me when I asked that this woman was in fact a student at the school. Seniors were allowed to take their study hall outside. I recall being astonished and wondering, why doesn't she just run away? The thought shows how far I had drifted in a way at St. Joe's and why private school would be a kind of homecoming. It wasn't going to be about the hard rituals of the playground or the downplaying of accomplishment, and certainly not about Jesus on a cross or being a soldier for goodness. There wasn't going to be any God and not much country either. School from now on was going to be about me, and not the authority over me, but the authority in me. Rand did extremely well on our admissions test, came a note from the head of school on my acceptance letter, and I remember my glow of pleasure. St. Joe's had made me feel as if my talents, whatever they might be, were irrelevant, even vaguely suspect. No one was going to be impressed by me because, well, impressing people was not the point. It wasn't the point of being human, of being a member of a family, of a school, of a country, or of being Catholic. Catholic and Protestant, it's easy enough to translate these impressions, as I've been putting them out to you, into concepts with hierarchy and community on one hand, meritocracy and individuality on the other. What I know is that St. Joe's remains important to me in memory, in large part for the obstacles that it put in my way. It restrained and even rebuked me, and in the process showed me things about the making of me as a particular kind of American. I was unhappy at the school, that's for sure. But unhappiness at that age, and for an embryonic writer in particular, is a gift to your own future, a rich text to be interpreted years later. In that sense, I was just unhappy enough at St. Joe's to make those two of the best years of my life. I'll deal more briefly, I promise, with the years I've spent working for Commonweal. The magazine is a complement, perhaps even in some ways a counterweight, to the kind of Catholicism I encountered at parochial school. While Commonweal keeps one foot in the world of local parish life, its other foot is planted in realities that are the opposite of parochial. For half a century, the magazine's efforts and its identity have been deeply intertwined with the liberalizing mission of the Second Vatican Council. It's a wide-ranging journal of culture and politics, as well as religion. It's Catholic. My grandmother used to love this distinction. Catholic with a small C. Well, she was an Episcopalian. She didn't want to be identified with Catholics. I never really understood that. So it's Catholic with a small C. For 20 years, I've been fortunate to do a very wide range of things at this wide-ranging journal, writing about books and movies, producing essays and columns on topics ranging from the perils of assisted suicide to the history of the music box. I have some advice for you students who are here to keep in mind. Whatever you end up doing once your formal education is over, you'll be happiest if it provides not only a livelihood and an option for service, but also a means of, in fact, continuing your education. Commonweal has done that for me. It's given me a grounding in a particular set of subjects, from just war theory to the history of anti-Semitism to the intricacies of our healthcare system. We have one writer in particular who writes brilliantly about that. Concepts that are useful to any citizen. The staff at Commonweal inspires me again and again with a kind of double idealism. The idealism of faith itself, but also on a day-to-day basis of taking ideas seriously, living as if ideas matter. College students may take this assumption for granted, but believe me, life will test it. a semi-secret thing I've done at Commonweal, alluded to by Paul Bauman for years, is edit many of the articles in the magazine. So now I get to out Paul Bauman. Let posterity know that, like an anonymous brushman in the Atelier of Rubens or some other famed master, I have actually performed many of the editing jobs commonly attributed to the great Paul Bauman. Many of those editing jobs involve taking on arcane academic topics and translating them, in effect, for a non-academic audience. I'll be delicate here, as I may be among your teachers, superb scholars, immensely knowledgeable about their subjects. But I will say that they, at times, have sent me a wander through some pretty dense thickets of prose. Paul Bauman knows that I must read one typical sentence, chosen entirely at random, from an essay by an accomplished university theologian. Not here, not anywhere near here, maybe not even on this continent. Here's the sentence. Even if the development of a strain of theology taking a pessimistic view of human nature damaged by original sin, as well as a supernaturalism replacing apocalyptic that could lead to passivity in the face of human poverty and disease, did not lead Catholics to think about human poverty and human emancipation that now seem a secure part of Catholic tradition, still the philosophical approach reinstituted by Thomas Aquinas and reaffirmed by the later tradition made it possible for Catholic teaching to accommodate and even sponsor scientific discoveries. Is it blasphemous to remark that such sentences remind the editor that we humans are, in fact, fallen? In this sense, the first draft of an essay for Commonweal is often profoundly Catholic. Another part of what I've been blessed to do is delve into the work of contemporary fiction writers, including those writers who take on questions of faith. And tonight I want to finish up by recommending two of them, one Protestant, one Catholic, suitably enough, whose writings address some of the themes I've been hinting at here. The first is the late novelist and critic John Updike. Updike is best known, although he wrote many, many books, frighteningly many books. He's best known for four novels chronicling the life and times of a basketball-playing alter ego named Harry Angstrom, also known as Rabbit. Religious themes, both in Updike's writing and in Harry Angstrom's life, cluster around three significant impulses: praise for the created world, awe at the mystery of human consciousness, and dread and disbelief at the prospect of personal extinction. Updike does a very artful job of steering Harry, who's not educated, through theological dilemmas. There's a memorable scene, I think it's in Rabbit Run, the first novel, of him golfing with his pastor. And while the pastor is lecturing Harry on his many moral failings, he's in the process of leaving his wife, it's Harry that Updike turns into an avatar of authentic religious feeling. And he does this, as some of you will recall, by having Rabbit hit one perfect golf shot and then voice his thrilled belief that such perfection on earth necessarily implies the existence of a creator, presumably a golf-friendly one, above. It's classic John Updike wittily using a very mundane staple of suburban life to cue up a spiritual ecstasy. And in fact, this golfing argument from design reveals a spiritual logic that is everywhere in Updike's fiction, namely that the existence of God in a sort of perceptual back-engineering way can be inferred from our own inexhaustible need to express wonder at the world around us, and for a writer, by his ability to describe it. Updike writes in his memoir called Self-Consciousness, "Imitation is praise, description expresses love. The four rabbit novels are crammed to bursting with the trivia of American life over the decades. We learn, for instance, that the ingredients of a TV dinner include Sistine and gum arabic, that Consumer Reports rates the 10-cup Krupp's coffee maker above the 12-cup Braun, or Brown, as it should be said, that the Philadelphia Eagles quarterback of the mid-1970s was Ron Jaworski, and on and on. Plenty of critics blasted Updike for lavishing exquisite prose on such unimportant stuff. And it's a cogent criticism. However, the critic James Wood, British critic and novelist, perceptively called Updike's plush attention to detail a form of, in his formulation, nostalgia for the present. Updike understood that, in a sense, all life is being left behind at every minute as we pass through our allotted stay on Earth. The self, he wrote in Self-Consciousness, is a window on the world that we can't bear to think of shutting. And that's why the rabbit novels are packed so full. They're the efforts of someone desperate to get as much in before that as he can, before that window on the world snaps shut. It's not Sistine or gum arabic that Updike was enraptured by. It's the action of rabbits' daily consciousness in registering these things. But what kind of religious faith does this add up to? For Updike, as his biographer Adam Begley, in a book that came out last year, noted, looking, seeing, and noting on paper were acts of worship. At a conference on Christianity and literature, Updike commented that realism forms an homage to the God of creation. Even, he said, in those many works of mine where religion plays no overt role, mundane events are considered religiously as worthy of reverence and detailed evocation. Updike died 8 years ago of lung cancer. And it came upon him, the diagnosis, very quickly. He died within 3 months of his diagnosis. The last story that he wrote, and it was published as he was dying, ends by evoking one of those mundane events in just the reverent way that he is describing. It's called The Full Glass. It's his last story. Updike's protagonist, his alter ego, is a man of 80. And he's standing at the mirror at the end of the day. He's holding a glass of water in one hand. He's got a bunch of his pills that he takes every night. And seeing all these pills that are barely keeping him going, it makes him brood about death. But then he drinks the water, takes the pills, and he finds that drinking the water brings what he calls a sensation of bliss, linking his mind to the child that he was many decades ago and to two places in his small town where he had had his thirst slaked. A country spring where he drank using a tin dipper, and the water fountain at a local gas station. Here's how Updike closes the story by evoking that memory. The water was cold, tasting brightly of tin, but not as cold as that which bubbled up in a corner of that small town garage, the cement floor black with grease, and the ceiling obscured by the sliding door tracks and suspended wood frames holding rubber tires fresh from Akron. The rubber overhead had a smell that cleared your head the way a bite of licorice did. And the virgin treads had the sharp cut of metal type or newly ironed clothes. That icy water held an ingredient that made me, a boy of 9 or 10, eager for the next moment of life, one brimming moment after another. To me, and Updike is probably my favorite writer, his vision was a radiant one, but it's ultimately a lonely one, too. You take your own cart to market, he wrote in a bit of advice in a letter to his young grandson. And this, too, was his vision as an artist. But making a religion of individual consciousness is an inherently isolating and self-limiting enterprise. Updike was an avid reader of Proust, and in his view, Proust's central message was that, and I'm using Updike's words here, the transformation of experience by memory into something ineffably precious is the one transcendent meaning each life wrests from death. The one transcendent meaning. It's as if Updike linked the very existence of God to the miracle of individual perception and to memory. He was raised a Lutheran, and he remained an intermittent churchgoer in adulthood, but his emphasis was never on the life to come. It was always on the life already lived. As he wrote in the last poem he published, he wrote 2 weeks before he died, "Perhaps we meet our heaven at the start and not the end of life." I treasure the poems, and I highly recommend them, that Updike wrote during those weeks as he was dying. I find them majestically courageous. To be able to write fully formed sonnets with intricately worked out rhyme schemes when you know you're going to die in weeks is an artistic monument to courage. But from a Christian point of view, they do exude a tinge of the heretical, as if God himself were dying and the world ceasing to exist because Updike is leaving it. Years before, he had confessed that my mind sends up silent screams at the thought of all future eons, at the thought of the cosmic party going on without me. He viewed the end of individual consciousness as a pure and total catastrophe. And his heroic effort of describing it as it approached in the lead up to his death created some of the most crushingly poignant writing you'll find anywhere in American literature, at least modern American literature, even as it conveyed the heavy burden such a view places on the self and gives us the unsettling and sometimes strange process of a man mourning his own loss. "All the days of my life," Updike wrote in that last poem 3 weeks before he died, "my life, my life forever." For the Catholic alternative, I want to recommend two terrific novels by Alice McDermott, who gave this lecture. Were any of you here when she gave this lecture a few years ago? One of my favorite writers. She's a writer of many amazements. Her fiction explores Irish Catholic life in and around New York City in the 20th century. I want to recommend two books. The first is At Weddings and Wakes. It's published early 90s. And it's set in 1960, and it studies a family through the eyes of three children brought on weekly visits in from Long Island to their grandmother's apartment in Brooklyn. They sit through long afternoons of their mother and her three sisters, their three aunts, pouring out decades of pent-up hopes and disappointments. It's a detailed tableau of what's been called lace curtain Irish unhappiness. Excuse me. McDermott is quietly experimental. She's a realist, but she's interestingly and quietly experimental in the way she structures her novels, and that's what I want to pay a little bit of attention to. At Weddings and Wakes is maybe the only novel I know that's told from a third-person plural point of view. A narrative built on such phrases as "the children saw," or "perhaps one of the children thought," or "to the younger girl, it seemed that." The kids' individual identities are suppressed. We barely learn their names. We get only a glimpse of their later adult lives. This gap between the extravagant detail of McDermott's prose and the very sparse individuation of the point of view characters, it's a recurring hallmark of her approach as a novelist, here and in a number of other novels. Her realism is as lavishly descriptive as Updike's, but the underpinnings of selfhood are quite different, almost opposite. In Weddings and Wakes, it doesn't really matter the individual consciousness who's seeing this. What matters is the this. For us, reading the novel is like being carried to a window on the shoulder of anonymous porters. We peer through to a world where wedding party bands play Galway Bay as men tell stories of gentleman Jimmy Walker, or a voice calls out, "Sweet Jesus, don't mention Parnell." A world where children are taught the lives of the saints by nuns with names like Sister Illuminata. McDermott continued this bittersweet ethnography of Irish Catholic life with her 2007 novel, Charming Billy, a great, great novel, which covers 3 days in 1983 following the funeral of Billy Lynch, World War II vet and lifelong resident of Queens. Through group reminiscences, we get to know who Billy was, an alcoholic, an incurable romantic who enjoys charming older ladies, who calms a baby by murmuring lines of Yeats, writes notes on napkins to hand the priest, calls his best friend at 2 a.m. to rail drunkenly against the passing of all things. McDermott pulls off a rousing and tender rendition of that stock Irish figure, the poetic rogue in love with his sorrows. The plot goes back to World War II and a lost love that helps explain Billy's unhappiness. But what I want to draw attention to again is how McDermott tells the tale. Once again, her narrator stays in the background, her identity blurry. At times, McDermott sits all her characters around the table, and there are many of them, and quotes them. Or she'll create a group monologue that reads on the page almost like an unedited transcript. There's a huge supporting cast in the novel, and you may find yourself flipping back through pages to check which Daniel Lynch it is that you're listening to, because there are two of them. Or wondering exactly how you got onto this story of Billy's cousin's mother's great-great auntie Eileen. It all becomes a little bit overwhelming, and it does so in a way that's carefully calculated to reflect back on us, the readers, as if the welter of names and stories and our resistance to it reveals our own attenuated capacity for family life. McDermott reminds us how crowded that life was in Billy's world, the sprawling extended family and the surrounding structures of neighborhood, church, of Irishness itself. This is the world of the cradle Catholic. And in a Commonweal essay, McDermott wrote about this topic. She described it as a system of unshakable associations that make up a thick Catholicism. I was reminded of this thick texture when I interviewed film director Martin Scorsese a few months ago, a great gig that Commonweal lined up for me and for the magazine. Have any of you seen Scorsese's new film, Silence? It sort of came and went very quickly, especially as a film for such a major director. But those of you who saw it know that it's a film, that a theological film, in that it takes on questions of faith very explicitly. But that's not, Scorsese fans will know, generally how he does Catholicism. Although he has had a few films that are explicitly religious in the theological sense, more often, especially in his early and autobiographical movies, it's what's in the background, like a cross glimpsed on a rooftop in Mean Streets. And I asked him about that. He said, yeah, that's a shot of my old neighborhood, meaning the Lower East Side of Manhattan, which was very different when he grew up there in the 40s and 50s. Or Harvey Keitel's character's quick outrage when the girl he's making out with uses a devotional candle as a romantic mood heightener. You can't do that with religious candles! The opening scene of Scorsese's very first movie, Who's That Knocking at My Door, shows in a sort of somber Bergman-esque way, an Italian woman, if any of you have seen it, you might not know, that's actually played by Scorsese's mother, who's preparing a sausage pie, like a huge calzone, and serving it to her children in silent, sacramental somberness. I asked him about that, of course. That was our family's Feast of the Immaculate Conception, he was very happy to tell me. Every year, December 8th. There are other kinds of Catholicism, of course, and other kinds of Catholic artists. I think of Flannery O'Connor, who said that the Catholic novel often fails because it tries to make a culture out of the church, and the church is not a culture. Yet the kind of Catholicism I've been describing is a culture and a community in the fullest sense. As such, it offers protection from that abiding American power of loneliness, a theme in our culture tracing back to pioneer days, the frontier and the open spaces, the long journeys across the ocean. American loneliness is not merely a production of geography, of course, but of ideology, the ideology of individualism that drenches and drives so much of American life, including, of course, American creativity, American genius. It's no accident that this theme has preoccupied sociologists over the last half century or so. The lonely crowd, bowling alone, loneliness as a way of life. There's a whole genre devoted to assessing the power of American life to isolate and atomize, and juxtaposing that to the contrary potential, never more evident than in urban immigrant life, of traditional, although not reserved exclusively to it, of traditional communities where the power of shared and assigned identity is strong. For me, in this context, after Updike, whom I love, reading McDermott is a kind of relief. It's a relief from the burden of individual consciousness as the be-all and end-all. Relax a little bit. Let your friends and family do some work. In McDermott, you don't take your own cart to market. Friends and families, neighbors and priests, they do. All those witnesses who gather together in her novel to convey the substance and adjudicate the value of Billy's life and death after his consciousness has been erased. To be sure, McDermott's novels possess their own kind of loneliness. I am rounding the corner to the finish line. And it lies in the fate of American Catholicism as it morphs and moves beyond the kind of cradle Catholicism I've been describing. What happens then? Charming Billy actually turns out to be told by the daughter of Billy's cousin, but you'd never know it because she's a ghostly presence, never named. We get only the skimpiest hints at her own life, a college graduate, married, living in Seattle, of all places, with her child and husband. A reader might legitimately wonder, why not simply dispense with her altogether? Why bring the narrator in as a character at all if you're not going to fill her out? These are the questions writers always think about when they read other people's novels. Like, what are you doing with that narrator? Why is that narrator here that way? Why is that narrator either not this or this? I think there's a reason for the anonymity of the narrators that McDermott keeps putting in front of us. Third-generation Irish Americans, they stand looking back through a kind of one-way window of assimilation at the world of a kind of Irish Catholicism that they've left behind. For better and for worse, this was the life of ethnic and religious community, loud, close-knit, restrictive. McDermott's point of view characters have left this behind. In Charming Billy, the narrator makes only a couple of comments about herself. She says, I married Matt, and we headed off to Seattle. Lives of our own, we said. Charming Billy suggests ambivalence about the trade-offs that come with a life of one's own. Things are gained, mobility, personal and intellectual freedoms, educational, professional status, but a lot gets lost. To shrug off the burdens of group identity is also to shrug off ferocious attachments, and McDermott's novels express doubt about whether anything as vivid and nourishing will take its place. The grand struggle to wrest yourself from the group delivers her ghostly narrators to a central American paradox that getting a life of your own, escaping a world where everyone owns you, brings actually a diminished sense of who you are. It makes you freer, but more lonely. In faith terms, it maybe puts you one step further on the path toward that church of leave me the hell alone. I know I've gone way long, but since I do one lecture every decade, I have to make it last a decade. I'm going to close with a final and I hope humorous last outing of myself. Paul Bauman will attest that despite my sojourns in Catholic land, I've retained something of the WASP worldview. Both my wife and I grew up in tidy little WASP families, both of us with fathers who themselves were only children. Mothers with one sibling each. In other words, we had no relatives. And we ourselves have eked out exactly one child, our daughter Larkin, whom we named, moreover, after the ne plus ultra of waspy British poets, Philip Larkin. So over the years, we've been perfectly positioned to enjoy the hilarious mockery of the Catholic-Protestant divide, and I'm taking my cultural references way low. Delivered in the old Monty Python movie, The Meaning of Life. Those of my generation, how many of you have seen this movie? Yes, some of you are already chuckling a little bit. You remember the scene in which a pinched, self-righteous, and lonely Protestant couple, somewhere in Great Britain, I think between the wars, watch out their window at a row house across the street, where an endless parade of children pour forth from the home of their Catholic neighbors, all siblings in an impossibly giant Catholic family, singing that well-known traditional Catholic song. Every sperm is sacred, every sperm is great. When a sperm gets wasted, God gets quite irate. The hateful Protestant husband, watching this with contempt and self-congratulation, says to his wife, "We're Protestants and proud of it. We don't believe in all that papist claptrap. We take precautions. That's what being Protestant's all about." This then was my tiny family's Protestant heritage, or so I thought. Imagine my surprise last year when I undertook some genealogical research into the Cooper family, part of taking my 88-year-old father back for a visit to that Philadelphia neighborhood he left so long ago. We'd always thought that the Coopers came over from England in revolutionary era times. But here's what I discovered when I went onto ancestry.com. And now I sound like a commercial, but I love ancestry.com. My great-great-grandfather, Warden Cooper, my grandfather's grandfather, in other words, came over as a boy in 1846. Not from England, but from Ireland. He married Jane, also from Ireland. And the two of them then proceeded to have not one, not three, not five, or seven, or nine, but 16 children. All quickly put to work as carders, weavers, and spinners in the textile mills of Philadelphia. 16 children. One woman, one couple. Is it possible that my ancestors were Irish Catholics? Doesn't the Monty Python skit say so? In any case, whatever it was, Irish Protestantism, Catholicism, it was very thick. I'm guessing there was plenty of God in that huge Cooper family, and I know that there was a lot of country, too, as the census reveals in the names, the list of names of children that include George Washington Cooper and Abraham Lincoln Cooper. And so I am, in the end, truly, at least an honorary Catholic. What can I say except that this is the glory of America? It sweeps you far afield, and then it closes a circle when you least expect it. Such wild plot twists make particularly suitable to us Americans the message of another epic religious farce in a different Monty Python film. Always look on the bright side of life. Thank you for your patience.
So we have a little time that we would love to hear from you, your comments, your questions. Yes, sir.
Enjoyed it very much.
Thank you.
Based on a novel by Endo. My other question is, are you familiar with that Japanese writer to recommend any of his other novels?
Maybe I should be embarrassed to say that the only novel of Shuzaku Endo that I've read is Silence. Have you read it? So there's another novel that the name, maybe someone else will know the name of it, that occupies itself much more directly and explicitly with the life of Jesus, and I can't recall the name of it, but I haven't read it. He was, for me, one of those many names that, you know, you're familiar with, but you've never read anything by him, and to me that list is appallingly large. And so for me, the occasion of the Scorsese interview was the means of reading that novel, which I found pretty fascinating. I don't know what you thought about it, but yeah.
The book you're thinking of is actually called The Life of Jesus.
And
it's not really a novel.
It's a nonfiction book.
It's an effort to represent Jesus as a gentle person for the Japanese culture.
Yeah. And also, I assume he was abidingly preoccupied by the difficulty, by the difficult mesh between Christianity and Japanese culture. And I think that book, The Life of Jesus, takes that up. Silence takes that up pretty directly, but I think The Life of Jesus takes that up exclusively. That's really what that book is. Yeah. Thanks, Paul. It's excellent to have people here who fill in the huge blanks for you.
Hi,
hey, good to see you.
Yes, it's been a while. Is this thing on?
Yes.
Yeah. It is, okay. I just can't resist popping up a softball for you, whether the response be humorous or serious, but in the context of group identity, religious group identity, ethnic identity, how do you view the question that people bat around now? Is the Pope Catholic?
Before I defer, I'm thinking about your question on so many levels because it's obviously the punchline of, you know, many a joking conversation. I mean, listen, we all have our own, whether we're faithful or not, our own political biases, default positions that are going to make us more or less hospitable, you know, frankly, this is to not only to each president as he or she, well, as he comes along, but, you know, to each pope. So how does the change from, from Benedict to Francis, does that make you feel instinctively like, yeah, I like it? The Pope, of course, is Catholic. Paul Bauman and others can fill you in with more detail about the very lively skirmishes that go on in some ways about your question, you know, beneath the often pacific surface of what we all think about the Pope. I love the Pope, but not because I'm obliged to. I'm not Catholic. But because, to me, everything that he says, the emphasis on his emphasis on pastoral care seems, among other things, a way of both sidestepping and diffusing sort of what the equivalent of Catholic culture war arguments that often rage uselessly, you know, from my point of view. So I feel like his political sentiments are probably in step with mine, but even if that's not true, he's insistently addressing issues through the lens of love, charity, and a slightly different level, pastoral care, which is both seems spot on, but also a kind of canny way of sidestepping some inflammatory issues. I don't know if that makes sense to you, but that's as far as I get with a take on that. But I'm sure Paul Bauman might be able to add something more. Do you want to add something more? You see why I like working for him?
I was told to keep it short. So I have a question, Rand. I was very interested in the way you were distinguishing between, you know, the Protestant writer like Updike and the Catholic writer like Alice McDermott. And, you know, it occurred to me that the Updike as a sort of quintessential Protestant writer, doctrine is quite close to the surface of his writing.
Quite close to what?
The surface of his writing. Whereas for Alice McDermott, it's much more got to do with practice or ritual. It reminded me, I was wondering, as you talked about the Catholic, the writings of Alice McDermott, how different the Catholic novel is from the Jewish novel in that regard. You know, that they're very much wrapped up in that community cultural thing. So the question, before you start answering me, the question is, I don't know if you think about these issues about the Catholic novel and the death of the Catholic novel and the existence of the Catholic novel, but do you think maybe those who are sort of unhappy about what they think is the demise of the Catholic novel are actually looking for something with more doctrine and less practice?
What do you mean by the last part, with more? So would McDermott be a doctrinal novelist?
No, she's very much, she's like the Jewish, she's the ritual, the practice of Catholicism, the culture, not so much.
Right.
The belief system.
So I think, you know, if you were to, I mean, the writer who comes to mind to me is Flannery O'Connor, really, as such a useful counterpoint to McDermott. I love Alice McDermott in part because one of the things I love when I read a novel is to enter a fully imagined, rich world of places, people, and characters. Now, I can organize her opposite Updike in the way that I just did. As writers, they actually share a great deal. Because of the way they use descriptive language, there's nothing spare, really, about either writer. I can imagine trying to sort of channel an answer to your question by imagining a Catholic, a reader unsatisfied with McDermott. There could be a sort of, you know what? A, that's ancient history. We're way beyond that. This is sort of a museum piece kind of fiction. It's nice for what it is, but it's essentially nostalgic. O'Connor, Flannery O'Connor's writing would seem to have a much more kind of portable challenge of faith to an actual reader looking to engage that kind of thing. And McDermott doesn't really offer that. So I would put her, I tend not really to think about where is the Catholic novel right now, but if you ask me to think about that, I think, well, if someone wants that, they have it in a writer who actually wrote 40 years ago. I don't know if you have other kinds of writers you have in mind that you would put in that slot.
Well, but, I don't want to hug this, but I mean, I think that the individuals who are less happy with what they think is the decline of the Catholic novel are not going to be happy with Flannery O'Connor because that was 40 years ago.
Right.
Or they are happy with Flannery O'Connor, but where is that kind of novel today, they would ask.
I don't know.
Someone else
can toss some names in.
I was just wondering, I don't even know if Marilyn Robinson, is she Catholic? I know her stuff.
Calvinist,
yeah. But her stuff is very, at least housekeeping was, don't you think? I mean, in terms of hitting those, anyway, it's not Catholic. but it seems to be.
Well, as a narrative of contemporary life that's informed at some level by questions of faith.
Yeah.
It's pretty oblique in that novel, though, isn't it? I mean, it's possible to read that novel without even engaging that dimension. Right, but Ed Wheeler, who actually has read Gilead, and Ed, do you want to answer this question? Because you're very well positioned to answer it.
No, it's just that she takes out
take the mic.
Her chief character is a minister, but it's also not set in the contemporary times. It's set in the maybe 30, 40 years ago, even longer. But he directly faces the especially in Lila, dealing with the situation with his wife, who has a rather strange and unconventional background. He actually preaches a sermon to her in the course of Lila. The doctrinal elements come right to the fore quite explicitly. So that's the only thing I can answer.
Your comment about being the young Protestant lad at St. Joseph's School put me in mind of Thomas Merton, the monk poet, who had a somewhat similar experience. He was a Protestant at a French Catholic school, the Lycée Ingres, in Montauban. He was he looked forward to recess every day because that's when he would be beaten up. And when he graduated from the school, there was a sweet irony in the fact that this English lad born in the Pyrenees of a New Zealand father and a Long Island mother won two prizes. He won the prize for French literature and the prize for religion. And he was the Protestant kid who was English. It never left him. About a couple of months before he died, it was published actually after his death, so it was in 1969, the novelization of his experience appeared under the title My Argument with the Gestapo. And what he talked about was the cruelty and the tyranny that he tasted in that homogeneous Catholic experience. Now, it didn't seem to be, in the end, overwhelmingly damaging because he became a monk. But have you thought of writing either a story or a novel that produces some element of revenge on the Catholic experience? Or was it entirely as affectionate as you chronicled?
That's a great question. I'm just thinking about how to answer it. What was the title of the novelization, Merton? My... Mm-hmm. I'm not really in a fiction. I'm sort of a post-fiction writer, so it's been a while since I've done that for various reasons that really aren't worth going into. I have written in a somewhat more acerbic mode elsewhere, a little bit about these things, about Catholic school. You know, you choose different versions of, if you're going to write from and about your own experience in a memoiristic way or an essayistic way, you choose different things to look at. So it's something I have thought about, yes, in fact, and something I've done in Commonweal. I wrote a piece years ago that received a lot of flack in the magazine. About some ambiguous interactions I had with the priest there, whom I mentioned here, and it takes a very different track from what I talked about and what I read tonight. So you know, as for most experiences, they're powerful. There are contending valences, on either side. At least I find that.
Do we have?
But thank you for that.
Do we have a last question for the evening from somewhere or someone?
I just want to say to all of you, Paul, thank you for inviting me for this. And it's a weeknight, and I know how the pace of. I have a young daughter. I know how lives work. I know what time people get up. And I want to thank you all for coming out tonight. It means a great deal to me, actually. Thank you.
So our thanks to Rand. Just two quick things before you leave. First, there may be those among you, a few of you, who might be expecting an event on Saturday morning this week. We have canceled that event, so if you were planning to come, don't come. And if you weren't planning to come, you're not missing anything, okay? The other thing is just to remind those of you who are here because you're part of the nascent Commonweal community. If you stay around, you and I will chat for a while about how we're going to organize our little group. So thank you all for being here. Thanks again to Rand, and thank you, Paul, for being here. And thank you to everything to do with Commonweal, the greatest Catholic journal in the world.